Hello everyone, welcome to lesson 40 of our GoLang course. In this lesson, we are going to practice whatever we went through in the last lesson when we talked about different uses of pointers. So let's get started. If you declared a variable var a int value 10, since this is a variable, you can mutate the value of it. That is, throughout the program execution, we can update the value. Say a is equal to 20, and if I do fmt println a, we should see 20 printed to the console. As we expected, 20 is printed to the console. Now I have changed the kind of a to a constant, that is, it's immutable. So we cannot change the value of a in the program execution. As you can see, the IDE is already complaining about an error. So that's the basic difference between mutability or variable declaration and immutability, that is, a constant declaration. Now this is something that's valid between a function or at package level. What happens when you have a function that is processing the value and updating the value of a variable that is given? So for example, let's create a variable a is the int value of 10, right? Now I'm creating a function func increment that takes an integer value and increments it. Now let us pass a to increment a fmt println a. So what do you expect will happen here? Since a is a variable, we are passing a, and inside increment, we are saying x plus plus or a plus plus, and then printing the value of a. We would expect the value of a to be incremented here. But as you can see from the output, the value is still 10. Why does that happen? Go is passed by value. That is, when we call increment and pass the value of a copy of a is created, and x is initialized, and assign the value of a or the copy of a. So when we do x plus plus, it is actually performing the operation on the copy and not on the actual variable that's in the memory. That is why when we run this program, the value is still 10 when we do an increment. This is where we can see the first use of pointers. Now if I convert this to a pointer, I just need to add an asterisk in prefix of the data type. That means x is now a pointer to int. Here it's complaining because x is a pointer and we cannot perform arithmetic operation on a pointer. So instead, what I will do is dereference the value first. And here, since increment expects a pointer, we need to pass an address. So here I'm saying increment and passing a pointer to a or the address of a in memory. And in increment, we have the memory address and then we dereference the memory address and increment the value. That is to say, we are directly incrementing the value in the memory. So if I run the program now, let us see what the output is. As you can see, it was incremented correctly. So in this case, with the help of pointers, we were able to introduce mutability inside increment. That is, a different function can mutate the value of passed in value. Similarly, let's take another example of a structure. Here, I'm going to declare a structure student type student, which is a struct. Fields are first name, string, last name, again a string. Now I'm going to create a function update the last name for a student func, and it takes s, which is a student pointer, and then the new last name, which is a string, and inside it we do s.lastname is equal to new last name. In the update last name function, we are taking a pointer to student or student structure and a new last name, and inside it we're just updating the value of last name to new last name. So here I'm just going to remove it and create a new student object. First name code last name learn, and then we will call update last name, pass a pointer to student and add a new last name fmt println s. Since we are passing the pointer, we should expect when we print s, the new last name to be updated for s or the student object. Let's run our program to verify the same. As you can see, code new last name has been printed. If I do a copy of this here, you will see before the updation, the last name was learn. And as you can see, code and learn, then we performed an operation to update the last name using the pointer to s. And as such, we passed in a last name which was updated by the function update last name using the pointer. Here, there's a difference between increment and update last name. If you notice, in increment, we had to dereference the value of x before incrementing it. But when we use pointers to struct, Go automatically manages that for you. So it handles the dereferencing of value for you. In this case, we don't have to do star s. Instead, you can directly say s last name is equal to last name. Now let's look at another example. I'm just going to remove the increment function from here, and here update last name is going to return an error if the new last name is empty. If new last name empty string, return errors.new empty new last name. We haven't talked about errors yet, but this is your first preview of errors. We will talk about them in a future lesson. If there's no error, we return nil. Let's now also update our update last name to also send the previous last name or the last name before updating as a return value. So we will return string with error. So to correct that, I am returning empty values with nil. In this case, we can say previous is equal to s.lastname and then return previous last name. Now we have updated the update last name function to return a string and an error value. I'm just going to remove these print statements from here to reduce the noise. To sign these values, we can say previous last name and error are equal to the return value of update last name. If error is not nil or if there's an error, we will just do fmt println error and fmt println previous last name. So now let's run the program and see what the output is. I don't expect any errors since I am passing a last name and it's not empty. Go run main.go. As you can see, the previous last name learn was printed. But what happens if I pass an empty string? In this case, we expect an error, which we do see, which is empty last name. If you notice, there's an empty line here, which means previous last name was still provided. In some cases, to make sure that the calling function is not able to use the value that we return when there's an error, you want to return a nil value that cannot be operated upon. In that case, we again use pointers. So in this case, I will modify the update last name signature to return a pointer to a string and an error. And here we will just do address of previous and nil. So in this case, when there's an error, you will see the previous last name is nil. As such, we are preventing a lot of bugs from happening. That means the following program here cannot work on the previous value. I just noticed there's a typo with the previous last name, so I'm just going to correct it. So back to our topic, providing nil when there's an error means we cannot operate on previous last name when there's error, preventing us from adding bugs into our code. This also means we are forcing the caller to appropriately handle the error. If I now run the program, since there's an error, we should expect nil printed to the console. This is a very common pattern in Go, where you return error along with the nil value if there's an error, but if there's no error, we just return the pointer to the value along with nil. Now the third case is where student structure can get really big. I'm just going to remove all this and create a new function func prettyPrintStudent, which takes student and prints the details of student. Fmt print first name, then a placeholder for string, a new line, last name, placeholder for a string, and then s.firstname to replace the first placeholder, then s.lastname to replace the second placeholder. I just want to add a new line here, so I'm going to add backslash n. We don't need errors anymore, so I'm just going to remove it from here. Here, if I do prettyPrintStudent and pass s, we should see the first and the last name printed as a formatted string. So go run main.go. As you can see, first name code, last name learn. What happens if the student struct gets too big? We keep on adding values, classes, which is a slice of string, guardian, again a string, age, int, height, int, weight, and assume there are many more fields in this. In this case, when we pass prettyPrint to a student, since we are not passing a pointer inside it, we create a copy of student every time we call prettyPrint. That means a new copy has to be created in memory, which is very expensive for your program. Instead, we can use a pointer. If you remember correctly, pointers have the same size for any data type. That means no matter how big the student structure grows, the size of the pointer will remain the same and the program will work the same. So now let's run our program to see the output. As you can see, it's still working. So in this case, we are not mutating the value of student inside print student. Instead, we are just using it for performance gain. Don't worry too much about performance gains. There are a lot of linting tools that you can configure to remind you if passing a struct as a copy or not a pointer will have significant performance implications for your program. In this lesson, I talked about that Go is pass-by value language. This is something I want to cover in the next lesson. So this is it for this lesson, but in next lesson, we will cover pass-by value feature of Go. Thanks for watching. Happy coding.